Timer set, go. Here you see a charge. If we make it move, we have a current, I. If we add more charges, we have more current. Moving charges in a straight line like this gives us a constant current, direct current or DC. Moving them back and forth creates an alternating current, AC, although we just look at DC for now. Why would charges move? Because they want to move down their potential. What does that mean? When you have a battery, it will have a positive side and a negative side. We say that the positive side has a high potential, the negative side has a low potential. As the rule on circuit analysis, charges want to move from high potential to low potential. How badly they want to move is called voltage. So, if you have a low voltage, something like 3 volts, you might have a 40 milliampere current. But if you have a high voltage, something like 9 volts, you might have a current of 41 milliamperes. The ratio between voltage and current is called the resistance. So if the voltage is 1000 times as high as the current, we say the resistance is 1000 ohms. Let's look at these guys in action. This is the symbol for a voltage source. It can be something like a battery or anything else. This is the symbol for a resistor. It can be anything that uses electricity. Let's think of it as a lamp. In this example, a 9 volt battery with a 90 ohm resistor gives us a current of 100 milliamperes. To tackle hard problems, we'll need a new law. Kirchhoff's current law. It's pretty easy actually. It tells you that the current that goes in must also come out. So if this wire has 5 amperes and this one has 4 amperes, then you know that this one must have 1 ampere. Another related law is called Kirchhoff's voltage law. It tells you that if you go around the loop, you must end up with 0 voltage. This makes sense, because if it didn't, we could just go around twice to get a higher voltage, then again, and so on, and eventually have infinite voltage. Since that doesn't make any sense, you also get zero if you go around the loop. Let's apply these laws. Let's try to find the voltage in these resistors. By the current law, they both have the same current, because the wires don't break up. Let's say the current goes clockwise, and you can use the voltage law in this loop. So we have 3i plus 2i plus 9 equals 0. Keep in mind that the sign of the voltage source matters. Had we turned the voltage source around, we would have minus 9 in this equation. Solving this gives us I equals minus 2 amperes. The minus sign tells us that we're wrong about guessing the current went clockwise, so it goes counterclockwise. The voltages in the resistors is then 4 volts and 6 volts. Now there's a trick. There are two algorithms for solving any voltage and current in a circuit. I'll show you one here called mesh analysis. It goes as follows. Make up currents in all small loops in a circuit. To make it simple for you, let's just say they all go clockwise. Then just apply Kirchhoff's voltage law to each loop. You might be confused when two loops meet, but don't worry. You just need to realize that since they go in opposite directions, the resulting current will have a difference between them, where we switch the signs depending on which loop we're looking at. Now, you have some equations. All you have to do is just solve them. How do you solve them? Well, solved. Which brings us to the next theorem, Thevenin's theorem. This theorem will almost seem too good to be true. It tells us that no matter what circuit we have, whether it's really big or complicated or whatever, as long as it has two terminals, we can simplify it as a voltage source and resistor. So how do we do it? Well, the voltage is the voltage, so let's do it the same way as we did before. Resistance is a bit hard. First, you need to know how to add resistors. Remember in a previous example when the 2i plus the 3i just added, that wasn't a coincidence. In fact, whenever two resistors are right behind each other, we say they're in series. Whenever two resistors are in series, we can just add them, and then again, as many times as we like. The second way to add resistors when they are in parallel, that is, when their start and ends are attached to the same point. Then we can add 1 over the resistance, and finally flip that. So here we would have 1 third plus 1 sixth equals 3 sixths. Flip that so the total resistance will be 2 ohms. Now let's go back to Thevenin's theorem. To find the resistance, we just have to add all the resistors in the hard circuit. Since we don't need the voltage sources, we can just ignore them. So let's do it. 1 twelfth plus 1 fourth plus 4 twelfth. Flip it to get 3 ohms. They are in series now, so 3 ohms plus 1 ohm is 4 ohms. So resistance is 4 ohms. Neat. Tea break. Ok, Okay, so two new components. Let's first talk about capacitors. A capacitor consists of two plates, but it's a bit weird since they aren't even connected. When you connect a battery to a capacitor, it will store charge. We say that the capacitor is charging up. It will continue charging up until it has the same voltage as the battery. Now, if we were to increase the voltage on the capacitor, then it would increase the current. If we were to lower the voltage on the capacitor, then it would also lower the current. So the higher the current, the higher the change in voltage. Remember, not the voltage, because it's possible for there to be a voltage and no current. It's a change in voltage. The ratio of current to change in voltage is called the capacitance, C. The inductor is very similar, but here instead of the current increasing with changing voltage, now the voltage increases with changing current. In this case, the ratio is called the inductance, L. Let's apply these components now. Because we were looking at the change in voltage and current, we have to add a time component. The way this is done is by creating a circuit that has the battery added at a specific time, which you should call t equals 0. Now, to solve for the voltage on the capacitor, we basically follow the exact same procedure as we did before. The only thing that has changed now is that for the inductor you write 3 times di dt, because that is the voltage. And for the capacitor, well, that's what we're trying to solve. So let's call it V. Then by the voltage law, we get this differential equation. Now we're done. All we have to do is just solve it. How do we solve it? Well... So there you have it. That's our solution. How do you find these two constants, C1 and C2? We apply the initial conditions that we have. That is, we check what the voltage was on this capacitor before we hooked it to the battery, and we check what the current was before we hooked on the battery. Without a battery, there's no current, so dV dt equals 0. And if we assume the capacitor was uncharged, then V equals 0. Combining all of these facts gives us a full solution. So now, let's take a quick look into the world of maths before we take a look at the scary AC current. In AC circuits, the current is moving back and forth. The maths for this is doable, but there are nice tricks to make it simpler. Instead of thinking of it going back and forth, we imagine it moving in a circle. It's going up in the imaginary dimension. We can look at its real component to see the real current at that time. Remember that the circle doesn't actually exist. We just made it up to make the maths easier. So now, from your maths class, you'll remember that the complex numbers moving in a circle has this equation. We're going to write it in phasor form, which looks like this. Comparing these two equations, we have one in the phasor domain and one in the time domain. Now let's relate this to circuit elements. Current is simply this in phasor form. Voltage is current times resistance, so that's this. The relation between voltage and current in an inductor contains a derivative in the time domain. If you take this derivative in the time domain, we see that all you have to do is multiply by j omega L. Likewise, for a capacitor, it's 1 over j omega C. So there you have it, all relations. As you can see, inductance and capacitance can be seen as sort of imaginary resistances in the phasor domain. For that reason, we like to group all of them together and name it impedance. So now, let's go back to this example and try to find the current. Instead of adding the battery at t equals 0, the battery will have a voltage of cosine of 60t. The only difference in solving this now is that we simply write everything in the phasor domain first. This can be done with the nice relations we had before. Now all we have to do is add the impedances since they are in series. So let's do that. Then all we have to do is divide the voltage by the impedance and we got the current. But now we have to address one final question. Why did we calculate all these voltages and currents? Well, that's to calculate the power. That's what you eventually want. Power is a product of voltage and current. But as you know, AC current can make this a bit tricky to evaluate. There's so much to say about power in more advanced tools for analyzing circuits, like the Fourier transform, Laplace transform, and so on, that I can make several videos for those topics. So, I will. Stay tuned for those videos. And in the meantime, leave a comment to tell us what your opinion is on this video.